In the 1990s, the Cleveland Cliffs Iron Company found something weird in their sand pit. An entire buried forest. And I'm not talking about a pile of old logs. I mean, trees are still standing straight up. There are needles on the forest floor, perfectly preserved, buried forest from more than 11,000 years ago. If you went to the site today, you would see nothing. But 30 years ago, researchers got to get in, take samples, and save pieces of this site for future generations. And I got to talk to them about what they learned. This is the story of the Gribben Basin Buried Forest. This forest of spruce trees grew outside of what's now Marquette, Michigan, near the town of Palmer. And it was probably the first forest to grow in this spot in many years. See, until recently, this land had been covered by glacial ice. And when the ice melted, it left behind a barren landscape. Over time, trees from the south advanced north until they arrived here for the first time in forever. And that is a useful piece of information, so hold on to that. But for now, know that this glacial ice wasn't far away. In fact, the ice had recently surged south thanks to a short period of cooling in the northern hemisphere. So this forest was only a couple miles away from the ice at most. In that way, it was comparable to forests we find today in places like Alaska. And for decades, all was well. But then that short cooling period ended, and the ice quickly started to melt. Sand, gravel, and water flowed toward Gribben Basin, and it didn't take long for that flooding to kill all the trees. But things didn't stop there. Over time, the entire forest became completely buried in sand and was drenched until it was underwater. But this happened in a very specific way.
But what was interesting was how this particular site was buried and how rapidly it had to be buried, but how also gently it had to be buried, because it was gentle enough and rapid enough, to have the branches all on the tree going on up, and sand all around these branches, and they're not even broken off in many cases.
Yeah. When we got down to the layers of sand, you could find the forest floor horizon that had whole needles in it still, and it had cones from the trees in it.
That means the process of burying these trees was it's like Goldilocks time, right? It's just right for to preserve. And then it stayed wet for 10,000 years. These trees never dried out, or they wouldn't have made it.
This is wild to me. To recap, what they're saying is that these trees were buried on just the right timeline. If the sand and gravel had rushed in too fast, the trees would have been knocked over, and the needles and cones on the forest floor would have been swept away. But if it had happened too slowly, the trees might have rotted before being fully preserved. In their research paper, the team even wrote that this fast but gentle burial was so perfect that they were able to study pollen on the forest floor here. All of the trees they found were spruce trees, but analyzing the pollen taught them that there were other species growing nearby. There's also a third piece of luck here, because how did the researchers even learn about this site? And also, let me give you a proper introduction.
My name is Glenn Mroz, and I'm president emeritus of Michigan Tech University. At the time of this study, I was the dean of the School of Forestry, which is what it was called then, and my area of expertise at that time was silviculture, which I know hardly anything about anymore.
My name's Dave Reed. At the time of the study, I was professor in the School of Forestry. I became vice president for research and was in that position for a number of years. And my forestry expertise is measurements, inventory, statistical analysis.
I'm Ted Bornhorst. At the time of the study, I was a professor of geology. And subsequent to that, I became executive director of the A.E. Seaman Mineral Museum, and now professor emeritus. I was the lone geologist on site. These guys had a lot of foresters, you know, they outnumbered me more or less.
We didn't give them too hard of a time. Ted and I met as freshmen living in Wadsworth Hall, That's what, this goes right back a long way.
So one of our team members was Pat Martin. He's an industrial archaeologist. And he was giving a talk over at the Iron Industry Museum. And at a dinner, he was sitting next to a guy from the mining company that said, "Hey, we're finding trees again. Are you interested?"
It just so happened at the same time I was working with on ski racing with a guy who worked for the mine and got the same story from him when I asked. We found out from Pat that they were finding trees. But we had to move fast because they basically pumped down the water table to get their sand out. And then when they got enough sand for the year, they just let the water table come back up. So everything would have been flooded at that point. So we had a couple-week window to get in there and get samples. And
so if you wanted to take a disc out of the tree, you had to dig all the sand out of the way, right? You dig the sand out of the way, and water would start filling in from the bottom. So you had he had to jump in with a chainsaw real fast, 140 times, and cut pieces apart while other people were mapping them and numbering.
One of the news stories called me a paleo logger.
So when you were out there poking around and taking samples, did you sort of know what you were doing, or did, or here's sort of what I mean.
Yeah.
At some point you realized
we didn't have a pool.
Okay, there we go. At some point you realized these were 10,000 year old trees.
So we didn't know that till quite a bit later, because we brought wood samples back, carbon dated them, but you have, at that time, you have to put them in the envelope, send them somewhere, and they have to do their thing, and then they eventually get back to you with what the results were.
You know, we knew that these were probably connected with retreat of the glacier, so I think we pretty much suspected that it was 9,000, say 700 to 10,000 something.
Yeah, but we didn't have that confirmed.
No, we didn't have it confirmed till somewhat later, because that even after we put the stuff in the paper bags to get analyzed, it still took a long time to get the data back.
Right.
What is a long time?
It's like 6 months.
It was months.
So this was, I was done. We were done and they had flooded it by the time I think we got that data back.
Also, speaking of timelines, you'll hear me say that these trees are around 11 to 12,000 years old, but you'll hear the researchers say 9 to 10,000. And this is because of a quirk of carbon dating. Living things like trees take in carbon from the air to build their bodies, but there are different kinds of carbon out there. One called carbon-14 is unstable and decays into a different atom at a very steady, predictable rate. About once every 5,700 years, you can expect the amount of carbon-14 in your sample to have gone down by half. So when you do carbon dating on something like a tree sample, you're trying to figure out how much carbon-14 you've already lost. Based on that, you can then work backwards and figure out how old that tree was when it died. The quirk is that the amount of carbon-14 in the atmosphere has changed over time. So when you get an age for your sample, you have to convert it from uncalibrated carbon years into calendar years. So in this conversation, the researchers have been talking in uncalibrated carbon years. But in calendar years, which is what I think about, these trees are actually about 11 to 12,000 years old.
The mining company came in and this was basically a borrow pit. They would pump down the water table and come in with large equipment to get sand for their processes. And that's kind of how we found out that they were finding trees again. And when we went out to the site, you saw this plain of sand with all these round trees where they basically sheared them off because the wood, although it was preserved because it was saturated, it was pretty soft.
So it was luck, though, that we got to the site, but it was also luck that the trees were still standing and the water wasn't so rough to knock them all down. There's a lot of interesting coincidences that make this a special site.
Now here, I want to pause and mention that this team was not the first to study this area. About 20 years earlier in the 1970s, an almost identical situation actually played out at Cleveland Cliffs. Workers at the iron mining company were digging a basin for their waste rock, and their equipment kept hitting trees some 25 to 30 feet under the surface. At that point, the company invited researchers from Northern Michigan University in Marquette to come take a look. Their names were Dr. W. James Mary and Dr. John Hughes, and they took a few trees and samples for analysis before the mining company got their pit back and finished digging their basin. Also, while doing image research, I just happened to come across this old newspaper article, and they report that the reason Hughes and Mary learned about this site was because a bulldozer operator at Cleveland Cliffs happened to run into his buddy at the bar and told him he kept hitting trees. His buddy was a graduate student at Northern, and he then told his former instructor, Dr. Hughes. Cleveland Cliffs was very supportive of this research and actually funded a good portion of it, but according to this newspaper, it seems like that initial connection, much like in the 90s, was made in part because of good luck. That said, I do think it would have been difficult for the Michigan Tech team to learn about this work some two decades later. Although Hughes and Mary did present their research to other scientists at a couple of conferences, so far as I can tell, after some fairly extensive digging, it doesn't seem like they ever published their results in a scientific journal. After our conversation, Dr. Bornhorst mentioned that he was at least aware of the work because he'd heard about it from a colleague, but it seems like nobody on the team really knew the details, if they knew about the study at all. But let's go big picture for a minute. This discovery was awesome, but it was also more than just a neat thing. Earlier, I mentioned that this forest was probably the first to grow on this spot since the glacial ice retreated, and I said that was useful. Here's why. Scientists often use data about the past to try and predict the future. For instance, they might look at how trees responded to a fast-changing climate 10,000 years ago to try and predict how forests today might respond to the climate change we're facing now. But if your information about the past is wrong, then your predictions about the future might be too. So here, the big question was basically, did trees grow, spread, and act the same way 10,000 years ago that they do today? It was a hard question to answer for sure, because these kind of fossil forests are rare, and the trees are usually all knocked over. But Gribben Basin was a clear snapshot of exactly how a forest grew back then. And what was it like?
For 140 trees, we, with a chainsaw, we took a disc, brought it back, and counted the annual rings so we knew how old all the trees were. And we could put together kind of a common growth pattern for the site. We had a number of trees that were over 120 years old, and so we could look at how they were doing, and it was very normal. It looked very normal, typical growth curves for white spruces, which is what these trees were. So the implication is that the ecological and landscape level processes that were happening in North America at deglaciation were very similar to what's happening today as plants advance their range. And plants are advancing range now.
And is this climate change related?
Okay. So, yeah, if you want to use past trees to try and predict the future, it's pretty safe to say that you're making a fair comparison, at least in these kinds of environments. But also, let's be honest, studying this site was also just a really cool time.
The interesting thing about this, and it was one of the most fun things I ever worked on. I never did field work with an archaeologist before. I had done some field work with geologists, but in the forestry people, and if one of those components was missing, it wouldn't have come together. The story wouldn't have come together.
And I thought it was sort of fun, you know, we'd be out there cutting trees and you're looking at it like, are we really doing this? This is amazing, you know. And I, you know, and we've luckily, they've been, most of them are preserved still and most of them are in the freezers.
I think so.
And which is cool, you know, that we preserved them for somebody else. There are numbers of studies, I suspect, that somebody could come in there today and do.
We couldn't really do any genetic work on these trees at the time. You know, we couldn't look at the question, or were these trees like the spruce trees that grow in the UP today, or were these trees genetically related to the ones at the northern end in Canada of their range? So we couldn't answer that question. The technology to do that just didn't exist. Now it does.
I spent a fair amount of time digging holes, you know, as a soil scientist and a silviculturist. And you know, you're digging a hole and you're down, you know, maybe 6-7 feet and looking at layers of soil development. And you know that it's old, you know, it's thousands of years in some cases. But to go out to a place like this and have the trees standing there that you knew were that were growing 10,000 years ago, and then digging in the soil around it, it gave you a real different perspective on time and, you know, and how ephemeral not only forests are, but our own existence is, much less than forests.
Today, any trees that remain at the exact site these researchers studied are, at best, back underground and underwater. With all of the sand and water in this area, it would be practically impossible to keep this site open and accessible long-term. But there might be other sections of forest still out there. Maybe in a few years, somebody will accidentally unearth more ancient trees. And maybe, once again, they'll teach us something new. Thanks for being here, and thanks in particular to the folks who support this series on Patreon and Buy Me a Coffee and allow me to keep making more videos like this. I hope you learned something that makes you think about the world just a little differently, and I'll see you soon.